and welcome to another episode of FooBar. Today, we are going to talk about the latest launch from Lambda. And this is the increase in the temporary storage of the Lambda functions from 512 megabytes to 10 gigas. Yes, 10 gigas. So let's go and talk a little bit about what this means. Since Lambda were created back like 6-7 years ago, they were born with a temporary storage, like an ephemeral storage, where you can store the things that you are working on. And until a few weeks ago, it was only half a giga. And that was great when our memory in the Lambda functions were not that big and the amount of time that the Lambda was executing was not that big. But the more and more we increase the memory, now up to 10 gigas, and we have a timeout of 15 minutes, then we needed a bigger temporary storage. So this temporary storage is configurable, so it's not something that you will get the 10 gigas right away. No, you need to set it up, and I will show you how to do it. So if you don't change anything, your Lambda functions will have what they've been having until now, 512 megabytes. But you can change it, and you can set it up between that, what it was before, and the 10 gigas. So you don't need to have the full 10 gigas, but you will have whatever you need. Also have in mind that this temporary storage adds to the pricing of Lambda. So read the pricing documentation if you are going to play with this feature on how much it's going to charge you. So then this temporary storage is what we are familiar in the programming languages where we store in this backslash temp. It's a temporary storage that you should not trust that there is anything there when you start a new Lambda invocation. Basically, you will download your libraries, your whatever you need, or you will get a file from S3 and store it there, or you will do all kind of things and store it there, and then you will work with that and then delete it. So that's the idea of the temporary storage. There is other kinds of storage in S3, so we have the ability to connect to EFS. I made a video about that. That's the Elastic File System. And you can basically attach an Elastic File System to your Lambda functions. And there you can have a file system like the one you're used to in your computer in Lambda. But that's a different story, and that's a different type of storage. We also have the ability to store things in S3, but you need to take them out and down, and that's why you need the temp storage. We have Lambda layers, that is a way to store some things that you might need later, so that's another way to store things. But the temporary storage is always there and is always needed, because at the end of the day, it's what you will use to work with Lambda. So making the temporary storage bigger allows for newer use cases with Lambda. So now you can, if you want, do ETL jobs, the extract, transform, and load jobs. So you can get a lot of data, transform it, and then save it somewhere else using Lambda. Before that, that was possible, but you really need cannot exist the half giga because temporary storage. You can do machine learning, you can get bigger models, you can get a lot of files in your Lambda function and work with that. So that's something that you can do. There is examples of using machine learning also with EFS, so that's something that has been possible. Then you can do data processing, SIP processing, graphics processing, and all kind of things that involves big files. Converting PDF, transforming video, adding subtitles. I will show you in the demo how to add a watermark to videos, because why not? But you can do all kind of things that before were not possible because the files that you needed to manipulate were too big. So I want to show you a demo today on how you can set up the ephemeral storage using SAM and how you can play with it. I will be adding a watermark to a video. I told you things you have to have in mind is that, for example, in the case of our demo, we are grabbing the file from S3, we are storing it in temp, then we are processing the file and we are storing that in temp. So it's not that I can play with a 10 gigabyte file. I need to be conscious that the file will be twice in my temporary storage, so maybe be careful on how big your file is. So have those things in mind. The code is always available in GitHub, so let's go to the console and see it in action. But before going, like this video. Yay! One important thing when you're working with this is make sure that you upgrade your SAM version. Make sure that you have 1.43 or higher, because this is something that is changed in the SAM CLI. If you don't have it like that, it will fail. So that's the first thing. Then I already deployed this project because I need to deploy many things. So I will show you the template YAML and I will show you all the different bits and pieces, but you can get it from your computer and deploy it. When you deploy it, you will need to give a ARN of a layer. I will show you how to do that. And also you will need, after everything is deployed, upload the watermark file into your source packet. I will show you as well how to do that. So the first thing you will need to do is your parameters, that is this Lambda layer, the FMMPG. I don't know how to pronounce that. FMMPEG layer. Well, it's this application that allows you to modify video, so you can resize it, you can add filters, you can transform video to audio, you can do whatever you want. And this is the library we are using. And we are using a Lambda layer that was created by Goitko at SIC. I'm very bad with names. And this is available in the SAR, in the serverless application repository. And you can deploy it, that layer, into your account, basically by going to the link I will leave you in the description box and then deploying that in the region that you are going to be deploying this project. And then grab that layer ARN that you get after the deployment. And when you deploy this project, you just paste that in the parameters and you're good to go. So that's the first thing. So have in mind that. And then after you do that, now you're ready to work. You can also create this layer for yourself, but I'm lazy, you know that. Then this application will create a couple of things. In those things are two buckets. So we have the source and the output bucket. The source bucket is where we will drop our files, the ones that will need to get watermarked or transformed in any way. And the output bucket is the one where we will get the results. You can do it in one bucket if you want, different folders, that's up to you. But yeah, so there we are putting a unique name and everything looks good. Then other thing we have here is our function, and this is the edit video function. This is a normal function with node 14, like every time we have done. It has 10 gigabytes of memory. And this is something you can decide how much memory you want. I put the maximum because I can. but play a little bit with the memory. You might not need that much memory. Depends on your size, file sizes. Remember, the more memory, the more CPU. And if you're doing operations that are CPU intensive, like processing video, you might need better CPUs, so that's something important. And remember also to increase the timeout. I put it to 15 minutes, so then the function is up to max. So if it's processing the video, it can take up to 15 minutes to give me a result. But this is something you might need to tweak depending on the size of the files that you are processing. If you are doing 20 megabyte files, then that's a lot, that you have an overkill on memory and timeout. If you're doing a couple of gigabyte files, maybe you need to see if this is good. Then we have the new attribute, the ephemeral storage, and this is where it gets interesting. We have the ephemeral storage and we put the size here, and here you can put any size between 512 and then the 10 gigabytes. So that's how you put it, and that's why it's important that you have the latest version of SAM. So then we have an environmental variable that is the output bucket name, so we can save in the bucket, so that's good. And then the layer that we just deploy, and then a couple of policies, one to read from the source bucket and to write to the output bucket. And then the event that is basically getting triggered whenever we have a new file with the suffix .mp4 that is like a video file in our source bucket. So this is a typical event. One thing I noticed when I was doing this, and it was kind of frustrating, is that I was deploying this Lambda function, and well, first, if you put here the ref and the source bucket, it gives you a circle dependency because the bucket requires the Lambda, and the Lambda requires the permission and things require itself, and then it doesn't deploy and it gives you an error. So that's why you see that there. That's basically how I build the name of the bucket. You can see it in the top when I'm defining the source bucket. And in this way, I'm breaking the circle dependency. This is quite annoying, but that's how it is. So if you're a little OCD like me, that you like to have everything very symmetrical and good, you cannot do it like this. It will fail. So just put the name of the bucket as you form it in the definition of the bucket. Then there you can see that I have a Lambda invoke permission. And this is another thing I noticed, that when I was deploying this and I have the Lambda with the source event, and then I deploy it, and then the S3 was not appearing in my Lambda function. So when you go to your Lambda function, there is this S3 there, it was not appearing. So then I realized that I need to give permissions to the S3 bucket to invoke the Lambda function. So that's what I'm doing here in this little piece of code, in these 8 lines. So add that, so then whenever an object is created in the bucket, it has permissions to invoke the Lambda function. So that's the template. It's very simple, except for these couple of things that I just mentioning. And then, so then we will have the code, so we can go to the app.js and we can see the code there. So in the app.js, we have the start of our handler application, of our handler code, that basically it goes through all the objects that are coming in the event, in that bucket. So if we upload many elements, then it will execute for each, and that will add the watermark for each of the objects. So we are getting the bucket and the key for each object and passing it to the watermark video function. And the watermark video function requires the AWS SDK. We are configuring then the layer, and this is the path to the layer. And if you can see here, opt-bin- the name of the layer executable, let's call it like this, because this is not like a node thingy, it's an executable. Then that's what you see. If you want to learn more about layers, I have a video about that, so go and check it. And then we have the temporary storage there, what is the name, so then we can make sure that we are mentioning. Then we have a child process kind of execution thingy, and this is a node thing that allow us to run like bash commands from node. And we have a method to clean our temporary storage. I will look at it later. We have the file storage module there, and then we have a couple of constants there, the bucket name that we get as an environmental variable and the name of the watermark file that you need to upload with that name. You can change it if you want, but well, that's kind of restriction, and it looks something like this. My watermark is a transparent background with these FooBars in the corners. You can do the watermark you like. I'm very narcissistic and you know it. So then we are ready to start a watermark process, and here you will see all the steps are inside this method. First, we are going to get the objects from S3, and we have a method for that. Then we are going to get the watermark file from S3. Then we are saving all this stuff in the temporary storage. So we are writing it there so we can use it. And we are doing the same with the watermark file. And then when we have that in place, we are going to execute the method from the library. I will not try to say it again, to add the watermark that we just got to the file that we just got, and then produce a new file in the temporary storage. So that's what this execution does, and it's calling this this await function, that is the exec prompts, that basically is calling that that child exec that we imported, and it's promisifying it. So we are basically calling bash commands from our node application. Then we are reading that file from the temporary, so we can store it in a bucket. So that's good. And then we store it in the bucket. So there is not really much here weird, so it's good. And the last thing is we are cleaning the temporary file. So then when we execute this again and it's reutilizing the same Lambda function, the temporary file is clean. We could leave the stuff here if we want to reutilize it later, but don't trust that there is things in your term storage. So you always need to verify that there is something in there before thinking that there is something in there, if you know what I mean. So for example, you could leave the watermark in the term storage. So then you can modify this code that, okay, if the watermark is in the temp storage, then I don't do anything. But if it's not, then I fetch it. So that's something you can do in the code. Then we have another method that is called the temp cleanup. This is just deleting everything because I will trust that there is nothing in this particular example. So if you want to modify the code to have the temp file, the watermark file, when you're removing things, don't remove the watermark because then that part of your code will never get executed. So that's good. Now you have seen all the code. The code is in GitHub and it's all available for you to play with. So we can deploy it and you will see that when you deploy the Lambda function, if you go to the configuration, you will see that the Ephemeral storage is set up, the memory is set up and the timeout is set up. So that's good. We have increased everything to the max. Then you can see in the source bucket that we have the two files, the watermark and then a video. Then you can see in the source bucket that we have two files, and these files I uploaded before starting to record. The watermark that you need to have with exactly the same name for this to work, and then the a video, any video with any names, and that's the one that you are going to add to start triggering this process. But I tell you a trick, if you don't want to upload everything all the time, you can just rename the file. So I will do that. I will go to actions and then I will rename that file. And this will start the operation because S3 thinks that you're creating a new object, but you don't need to re-upload it. If you're doing tests, this saves you a lot of time because uploading big files, videos to S3 can be slow sometimes. So I just rename it and then good. It thinks that I upload it again. So then I can go to my serverless console. If you want to learn more about my plugins, there is a video, my extensions for Visual Studio, go and check it out. But here we can see the logs for this Lambda function, and we can see there is the event that is that triggers this function. We can see that it's picking the watermark, it's picking the file, then it's saving everything in the temp. And then we need to wait here because now it's doing the processing of the file, and this takes a while. The while depends on how big your file is and how much memory you allocated to your processing. So this will be done in a few seconds for this video that is a 20 megabytes video, but a bigger video might need more time. So I'm just clicking retry here until something happens. So when this is done, we will see that plop, new logs appear, and we are saving that into the temp file, and then we are uploading it to S3. And then we are cleaning the temporary file and temporary storage. And yeah, so if we go to the output video, output bucket, then we can see that there is a new file there that is the number 3. And if we download it and we open it, we can see that it has the watermarks. So this is a nice usage for the ephemeral storage. A lot of this you could do with the previous 0.5 GB. Because if you are working with smaller videos, this is doable. But now imagine you can do it with bigger videos and you can do it in batch processing. So that's pretty neat. So that's the video for today. I hope you like it. This code is inspired in my colleague James Beck's week post that he did for the Compute blog, AWS Compute blog. I will leave you that in the description box if you would like to dig deeper in this topic. There's also more information on the ephemeral storage, so go and check that one out. And with that, I see you next week with another episode of FooBar. Ciao, ciao!